Are you looking to expand your aesthetic practice and attract high-quality new patients? Discover the power of digital marketing in growing your practice with a personalized strategy session. Join Ryan Davies, Equa's Marketing Director, for an exclusive 90-minute meeting. Ryan and his team will invest hours prior to your session, crafting a customized marketing plan tailored specifically for your practice. This invaluable opportunity comes at no cost to you, with no commitments attached. Schedule your meeting with Ryan today by visiting www.businessofaesthetics.org/MSM and take the first step towards transforming your practice with the potential of digital marketing.
You're invited to join our exclusive monthly webinar brought to you by the Business of Aesthetics community. Don't let this chance slip through your fingers. Secure your spot now for a game-changing experience. Explore the details on our homepage at www.businessofaesthetics.org and get set to transform your strategies.
You are listening to another episode of the Business of Aesthetic podcast series brought to you by our gold sponsor, Equa Marketing. If you would like to network and share your experience with our podcast guests and other aesthetic industry professionals, join our Facebook or LinkedIn communities by searching for Business of Aesthetics. Prepare to be inspired as we introduce Ryan Davies, an esteemed professional and seasoned digital marketing advisor at Equa.com, renowned for his expertise in sales and marketing psychology. Ryan possesses a wealth of experience collaborating with companies and political campaigns. He profoundly understands the intricacies of consumer behavior and how it influences purchasing decisions. As a certified Sandler sales and challenger expert, he brings a unique perspective, employing innovative sales techniques that drive tangible results. Without further ado, let's dive in.
Welcome to another captivating installment of the Business of Aesthetics podcast. I'm Ryan Davies, co-host at the heart of the Business of Aesthetics community and podcast. Before we immerse ourselves in the riches of today's episode, I want to express my profound gratitude to all of you, our incredible listeners from the United States and all across the globe. Your willingness to embrace and share this podcast and your invaluable insights and experiences have collectively transformed our community into a thriving epicenter of wisdom and innovation. Your unwavering dedication is the cornerstone of our success, and we cannot thank you enough. Today, we're going to dive right into our main topic, the best ways to leverage NAP in 2024. And to help me today and co-host this episode with me, we have Naren Arulrajah, the CEO, the founder of Equa Marketing, a master of SEO, a master of NAP, and is going to be able to explain this to us in really, you know, the important ways for us to be able to understand how crucial it is for NAP to be leveraged the right way in 2024. Naren, thanks so much for joining here today.
Hey, Ryan, I'm really looking forward to it. I think you know as much about NAP as I do, so I'll answer the questions, and hopefully you can jump in with your two cents as well. So I'm really looking forward to this conversation.
I love it when we can have a great back and forth conversation about things that we're both passionate about, and we know how important it is. But I think, you know what, let's lean on you to start us off here. Tell our audience, what exactly is NAP, and why is it important for local businesses, especially aesthetic practitioners?
Absolutely. NAP stands for Name, Address, Phone Number Consistency. Just to set the context, you know, we all know that 95% of the practices get nothing from Google for free, or almost nothing in terms of free traffic. So 5% enjoy 95% of the spoils when it comes to free traffic from Google. So imagine being in that 5%, right? Like the 95% give Google $230+ billion a year to show Google ads. Now, if you're one of the lucky 5% who doesn't have to pay, you know, to Google $230 billion, which is from each practice, thousands, or even some cases, even tens of thousands of dollars, you know, then you have an unfair advantage. So we are really focusing on SEO. We are really thinking about, like, how do we get into the top 5% of practices that have this unfair advantage? And there are six things you have to master and continue to get better at if you want to be in that 5%. One of those six things is NAP. The reason I'm sharing this, I just want to set the context. So yeah, NAP is good. Yes, we'll get direct traffic from all these sites with your name, address, and phone number. But the bigger benefit is it also helps you rank on Google and SEO. So NAP is something that is extremely important if you really want to be in that 5% and have this unfair advantage of getting so much free traffic from Google. If that is, you know, one of your goals for this year or next year, then you need to understand this episode and you need to understand how to think about an app and how to improve it.
Perfect. Absolutely perfect breakdown of it. And again, like you said, it's I think there's some really interesting intricacies about NAP, and we're going to dive into that as well in terms of accuracy behind it, because it's I think it's really important for people to understand, like, when we say name, address, and phone number is exact and consistent, right, that we mean exact and consistent, and Google means exact and consistent. So let's talk a little bit about first, you know, how NAP consistency influences your local SEO, and by having that exactness to it all, what that brings to the table, the benefits that that can bring your practice.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's talk about NAP's link to local SEO and what are some of the benefits that brings to the table. So again, when we think about SEO, there are two parts to it. You show up on Google Maps a lot. That's typically what people refer to as local SEO. But general SEO is you show up everywhere on Google a lot. And for both, whether it's showing up on the maps or, you know, just anywhere on a Google search, NAP is important. It is one of those six factors. And the way it works is every single business has a name. Every single business has an address. Every single business has a phone number. Now, in the old days, there was one source of truth, and that was, let's say, Yellow Pages or Super Pages, right? I'm talking 25 years ago. So every business, you know, would get a call from, you know, your top Yellow Page directory company in your area, and sometimes it's one, maximum there are two, and they will say, hey, I'm just confirming that the address we have for you is correct. I'm confirming the name of your business is correct, all the way to spelling, right? Like, is there an extra space? Are we spelling it correctly? Are we putting a dot where we need to put it? So you verify all that. You verify the address, you verify the phone number, and the human being calls your office to confirm it. So very simple days. I'm thinking, you know, 1997, 1998. Every year you get one of those phone calls. Today, there are hundreds and hundreds of places that have your name, address, and phone number. And an example might be US News and World Report is a website. Yelp could be another website. Facebook has your name, address, and phone number listed. Google Maps has your name, address, and phone number listed. And then literally there are hundreds of these. And unlike the old days, these 100 companies don't have an army of people calling your office, confirming your name, address, and phone number. So what they're doing is they are kind of looking at the internet and kind of trying to make a best guess as to what your name, address, and phone number is. And these are all automated. So these are all programs that are doing this. And when they're doing things automatically, they don't know if the information they scraped from some other website is correct. They assume it's correct and they use it as if it's correct, but unfortunately it's wrong. So for example, you know, 79 Jameson Boulevard could be spelled, the whole word could be BLVD, could be BLVD dot. Let's say the way the boulevard is written in four different places is different. Now from a NAP standpoint, now it means you have inconsistent address, right? The minute you have inconsistent address, Google, remember, again, is a computer. It's not a human being that's going through all these hundreds of websites. It gets confused. And the more it gets confused, the more it thinks maybe you are a different business, maybe in two different places. And I'm giving a really simplistic example with Boulevard. Could be the business name. So let's say, Thriving Portland, Med Spa, right? So some people might type in Thriving Portland as one word. Some people might type in as two word. Same thing with MedSpa. Some people might type in as one word. Some people might type in as two words. So Google might think these are different businesses depending on how they are written. So your job or somebody in your team's job is to make sure everywhere on the internet over time, every single website has the exact same name, exact same address, and exact same phone number. Literally to spaces, to dots, to the way it's written. So now one tip I want to leave you with is it's not like you will never ever get 100. You will never get 100 because there'll be a new directory you never heard of that got created or an old directory where you had the correct information, now didn't mass update, and the correct information is replaced by incorrect information, right? So this will keep happening all the time. So when this happens, you need to have a team to just keep at it. Just make tomorrow better than yesterday. And a lot of times it'll feel like you're taking one step forward, two steps back. But anyways, I hope I'm giving you a 10,000 foot overview on, you know, what is an app? How does it help with both local or maps SEO versus regular, you know, everything else SEO, as well as some of the benefits you get when you do it right. The other benefit, of course, let's say you have correct name, address, and phone number in 25 places. Each one of those places acts also as a directory, meaning maybe there's only 10% people looking at each one of those directories times 25. That's 250 people who know who you are. Your information is showing up, and maybe you get a few phone calls from that. Maybe you get a few patients from each one of those, or combined between all 25, maybe you get 10 patients from those 25 websites.
I think it's a great breakdown, and I always use, and I do a lot of, as you know, right, strategy meetings with clients and potential clients and people that are out there looking at to improve their rankings. And I see it so many times, especially when you get into like, I'm at suite number 8. Well, now I'm number 8. Now I'm STE 8. Now I'm room 8. Now I'm, it's just, it can be so, as your address becomes more complicated, so does your NAP consistency. And I also see a lot of people, as you mentioned, with the name, they try and do how Google used to do it, where they would like hack Google in terms of they would put their name, but then in their Google business profile, it would be like, you know, as you said, thriving Portland med spa, colon, Botox, Dysport, Morpheus, and they'd list like everything in their business name, trying to be like, aha, when people search this, I'm going to come up. Google's gotten smart to that, right? And that punishes you now for doing things along those lines. So it's incredibly important, as you mentioned, from that credibility, that trustworthiness type of thing. We'll get into a bit more of that, I think, here as well. But I want to talk about, you just talked about all the benefits. I think it's incredibly important to talk about the other side of that, right? So the consequences and what happens when an aesthetics practitioner fails to comply with proper NAP standards. What are the repercussions of that? What can people end up seeing as a result?
Yeah, I think a simple way to explain the repercussions is, you know, we work with close to 500 practices, you know, close to 100 med spas and dermatology, plastic surgery type practices. And many of our clients, 95% of them never leave us. They stay with us year after year. So we had front row seat for the last, you know, 17 years to see what's happening with these practices. Some of them started from like startups, and today they are like 8 million in revenue, 9, 10 million revenue. Like, I mean, they have achieved the life's dream, right? I mean, these are like amazingly successful business owners, practice owners. And one of the things that you will start understanding as you get better and better at running a business and being successful, you know, some patients cost you, let's say, $200 a new patient. Some patients cost you $40 a new patient, right? So, for example, we track everything. We track the cost of a patient from SEO versus the cost of a patient from Google Ads. And we notice, at the very least, after year one, the SEO patient would cost 20% or 1/5 of a Google Ads patient. And the reason I'm using percentages as opposed to real numbers is, depending on the type of patient, some patients might be more expensive than others, depending on competition and how lucrative the patient is. Of course, the higher the competition and the more lucrative the patient, more people are willing to spend money. So maybe the cost is a bit higher. But if you're comparing apples to apples, I can guarantee SEO will be at least at most 1/5 the cost. I mean, good SEO of Google Ads patients. So now that we understand that, if you are not doing well with NAP, forget about SEO. You will not do well with SEO. It's like game over, forget it. It's almost like, think about getting into medical school, right? Has anybody who has, let's say, really poor, you know, MCAT scores or really poor GPA or really poor recommendations ever gotten into the best medical schools in the world? No, they don't. Usually the ones who get into the best medical schools are acing everything. So NAP is one of those things, one of those six things you have to ace and continue to ace day in and day out, week in and week out. You can't just do it for a week or a month or even a year and then forget about it. Why? All these hundreds of websites with your name, address, and phone number are constantly changing. So you have to stay on top of them, continue to fix them. So the repercussions on number one is you're going to pay 5 to 10 times more than somebody who does SEO well. I think that's a huge repercussion, right? Think about it over a 10-year period. I mean, imagine spending an extra $100,000, $200,000 in marketing times 10 years. That's $2 million that could have otherwise gone into your profit column or gone into investments in more technology. You're paying people better, is now getting wasted on Google Ads and other expensive marketing methods. The second repercussion is, remember I said each one of those sites will drive traffic. So again, if you're not on top of them, if you're not managing them, the amount of traffic you get from all those sites, amount of new patients you get from all those sites also won't be what it could be. So again, you're going to get, you know, killed on both sides. So it is a lot of work. It's not easy. Like, we do it for our clients. So, you know, we have 250 people, 14 teams, 9 teams are focused on SEO. And one of the larger teams we have is focused on NAP. So you need someone like that, you know, who's on top of things, who is watching it, who's working on it day in and day out.
I think it's absolutely perfect. And, you know, you talk about those 6 things that are all of those key factors. We don't need to go through them all here. But as you mentioned, this is something that's so incredibly important. And it also feeds into other areas of those 6, right? One of them is, do you have white hat, high quality external backlinks? Well, consistent NAP data is basically building local citations and backlinks from reputable websites. So if you don't have NAP, it affects that backlink score. So there's a snowball effect there. Google EAT, which is your expertise, authority, trustworthiness. If you don't have credibility because of inconsistent NAP and you're confusing search engines and customers, you lack trust now. So now you're dropping that score, right? So it's so incredibly important that NAP impacts. It's you know, it's that one thing where if it shakes, everything else kind of falls down with it. Like you said, forget it. Your SEO is done. So if you're not paying attention, if you're not acing this, you're not going to ace your SEO. You're not going to show up. And trust is so incredibly crucial in healthcare. We've talked about it a couple times now. Maybe expand on that thought for me a little bit more on accurate NAP information and how it contributes to building trust with patients that are seeking aesthetic procedures.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I'll use an analogy, right? Let's say, and you know, one of the things we do for our clients is track phone calls and tell them how they're doing in terms of answering the phone calls and are things getting better or not, right? Because imagine a $7 million practice, they are not going to have inferior anything. Everything is superior, meaning their phone experience is superior, their NAP is superior, their Lighthouse score is superior. Everything is like A+, right? Remember, these are the people who are getting into the top medical schools, and these are the people who don't take B+ or C- as good enough. They want A++. So imagine you have a problem where a lot of the calls are getting missed, right? Put yourself in the shoes of the customer. What are you going to think? Doesn't matter what the reviews say, doesn't matter, you know, who referred you to that practice, doesn't matter whatever happened before then, your impression of that practice goes down significantly. You're calling between 9 to 5, nobody picks up the call, it goes to voicemail. You're like, oh, they don't care about their patients. That's the impression you get. That impression will be really, really, really hard to change. In today's world, what do people do? The minute they realize that somebody is not what they thought they were, they go back to Google and call the next guy on the list, right? The next practice with, you know, who's ranking quite well and who's, you know, getting a lot of reviews and stuff. So same way, imagine like the example that Ryan shared, right? Some people stuff keywords in the business name, like, you know, does the, you know, thriving, you know, med spa Portland, now Botox, etc. That's the business name, one place. Some other place, it's Thrive Portland, right? All these differences. I mean, what are you going to think? They're sloppy. They're not paying attention to detail. And am I going to trust them with my face, my you know, my skin, you know, when they don't even care about their own business name? Like, it creates these, you know, thoughts and impressions in people's mind. And of course, that's one of the reasons I think Google is so picky on this, because Google knows how people think, and trust is so important. So they're kind of screening out all these people who are showcasing, you know, lack of consistency, lack of discipline, right? I mean, think about it. Think of one kid who got into the top medical school in the world who was not disciplined, who was not consistent. They just get screened out, right? Yeah. You have to ace everything. Same thing here. Google is screening out, because the last thing Google want is to send their users. Remember, people use Google 8.5 billion times a day, and they don't have to use Google. So the last thing Google wants to send their users who are trusting Google to a doctor who is so sloppy, so not on top of things, right? Google, of course, wants to be remembered for sending that patient to that particular doctor. So they're looking at this. So not only are patients not going to forgive you if you are sloppy in this, but definitely Google won't even let them see you, because Google is like, why would I waste my time showing somebody who's so sloppy with their own name and address by sending them, you know, traffic, especially free traffic.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what it comes down to is Google's pre-vetted, right? Who's at the top, and they built that trust in, like you mentioned. And as you said, they've kind of gotten around some of these hacks that people used to use to try and cut corners. And well, if you appear as Botox here, but then you appear as another name here and another name here, as I'm looking, what do you really do? Or are you just trying to kind of beat the system? And I don't know if I can trust you. I think that's a great call out from that one. So now, like you said, you want to get a team behind you. You want to make sure you're doing the right things. This is something that it's quite tedious to make these changes sometimes, because sure, if you're in control of a social media account, you can go in and change your address and make sure it's right. But for all of these data aggregator sites, as you mentioned, you know, there's who am I talking to? How do I get a hold of this person? How do I make the change? But you want to make sure you're doing that in order to leverage NAP effectively. So are there specific strategies around all of this that aesthetic practice owners can adopt to make sure that they're doing the right things with NAP, and it's not costing them in ratings, it's not costing them rankings, it's not costing them potential new clients?
Great question. I'm going to answer it in two ways. I'm going to give you some tips and best practices. Again, I'm not recommending you, the practice owner, or you, the doctor, to do this, because your time is worth a lot. You really, you know, shouldn't be putting 20 hours a month every month for the rest of your life on NAP. You should have somebody else, you know, take care of this for you, somebody who knows what they're doing. But here is what I would look for. You know, ask for a report on NAP at least every quarter, right? How many NAP sites are you managing, meaning where you have username and password and you're controlling? And of those sites you're managing, how many of them have exact consistent name, address, and phone numbers? So all these three pieces of information have to be exactly the same, literally to the way Boulevard is spelled, Suite is spelled, you know, that extra space between the name, two words in a name and so forth, right? Everything we touched on. So track it and then verify it. So make sure you don't have to do it, but whoever's doing it, at least on a quarterly basis, showing how your NAP is improving. Most practices, most businesses or marketing companies don't do it, so they have nothing to report. So you can really find out the solid ones from the posers. And the other basic test is, are you ranking for minimum 100 keywords or more? Like every one of our clients, the promise we make to them is by end of year one, you should be on page one, meaning top 10 results for 100 or more keywords as per Google Analytics. And it doesn't stop at 100. We have clients who have been with us for several years, we're ranking for 600, 700 keywords or more on top 10 results of Google. So look at how many keywords you're ranking for. Literally check them out. Ask them to give you that list of keywords, right? How many phone calls you're getting. But more specifically for NAP, show me what you have done for NAP for me this month. This quarter. How has that changed over the last quarter? How many profiles are you managing? How many have consistent information? And just keep making this metric move forward. The second part of our conversation is like for you today, like listening to this podcast. Okay, where do you start? What do you do, right? You're listening to this podcast. You probably have a gut feeling your NAP is not what it needs to be because you are not ranking for 100 or more keywords, which means either NAP or one of the other six things Google cares about, you're getting an F. That's why you're not getting into that coveted top 5% who gets 95% of the traffic, you know, unfair advantage bucket, right? So if you're in that bucket, then I suggest book a marketing strategy meeting. One of the things that, you know, Ryan, who's a marketing strategist, would do is to literally see how you're doing with NAP. He will find, you know, he will look at some of the, you know, top profiles where you need to have consistent information. Of course, he's not going to study 300 profiles and tell you what's going on, but at least the key ones, how are you doing? And most of the time, Ryan, like I know in these marketing strategy meetings, what percentage of clients, you know, within 10 minutes, you see NAP issues? Like in other words, you're doing your NAP research and you're looking at, let's say, their Google profile, their website, their Facebook, etc. You're spending 15 minutes. Like what percentage of them have NAP issues?
I won't be dramatic and say 100%, so I'll say 99. I think that's a pretty fair number. it's almost impossible because so many times businesses get listed places and picked up that they don't even know. Like you said, there's ones you control, there's ones you don't. And it's pretty easy to have something where I spelt out Suite here and STE here, or I did, like you said, Boulevard or BLVD. And it's just so many times I talk to people and they're like, well, that's just what Facebook suggested. That's what Google Auto put for me. That's what this did, that did, whatever it is. It happens. Like I said, it's so incredibly shocking. I'm still, you know, it's I might as well go play the lottery to find someone who's got 100% or close to it consistency within a few minutes of searching. Absolutely.
Yeah. So find out where you stand, right? So the information that Ryan is going to find and share with you, maybe you can take that to your marketing company if you really, really like them and they're ranking 400 or more keywords, so they can still improve it. But if they're letting you down, the other thing that Ryan will look at is how many keywords are you ranking for, you know, on the top 10 results. So of course, if you're in the top 5%, I tell Ryan, I'm the CEO of the company, Ryan, let them keep doing what they're doing, right? Things are working. If they are not, then we can give you a plan like, okay, what would we do to get you into the top 5% who's getting 95% of the free traffic within 12 months? What's the plan look like? So that's the plan that Ryan would develop as a marketing strategist. I really think just have that meeting, figure out where you are, right? Because you can learn all the theory, you can learn everything we are covering today. But if that doesn't turn into, solid insights and action items, then it's like, you know, you're going around in circles and same old, same old. The practice didn't do well in Google 2 years ago or this year, and it won't do well next year either. So get a feel for where you are. Any comments on, like, Ryan, what do you do in this marketing strategy meeting?
Yeah, I mean, it's really taking everything where people are, you know, you're spending your time listening and making notes and wanting to get better and improve, and just having me do all of the work for you to make it granular for your practice, right? So you understand where it is. And as you mentioned, you know, the time of our listeners, very valuable. When you look at it, this isn't something where they want to take 5-6 hours and go through and do it themselves and understand it. So it's great to get that synopsis from someone else. And that's something I really enjoy doing, and making it a very granular conversation to you, not what is NAP and here's how you can do it yourself, but here are the examples, here's what's happening. Like, this is actually, we go through and take a look at everything and spend that time to discuss, well, here's how you make those changes, or here's the plan moving forward. And understanding, like you said, are you doing the right things right now? If you're handing that off to somebody or paying someone to do it, are they doing the right things right now? And if not, is it a easy thing to do? Is it a heavy lift? What does it look like? And what is the ROI on making those changes? What would the future look like in 6 months, in a year, in 2 years, in 5 years down the line from doing that, right? And that's really what the strategy meeting is all about, understanding what it means for your practice, and especially in the world of aesthetics. It's very different. Some people are all injectable. Some people are very laser. Some people are, you know, more in cosmetic dermatology or in plastics or whatever it is. So even that conversation is very different, right? Really getting granular on where you are, your location, your competition, all of that, and bring that to the table to make it applicable for you and to put forward a success plan for you individually. So yeah, that's really, you know, it's a really straightforward, easy hour to spend and entertaining anyways. And you learn a lot. You walk away from it understanding a little bit more about your practice and where you want to get to and what's holding you back from getting there, and a plan to actually make it, like you said, make it tangible, right? Have actual action items to get it done and how to do it and things to that effect. So yeah, thanks, Ryan. Absolutely. If anybody wants to take advantage of that, you know, businessofaesthetics.org/MSM is how to book a time directly in my calendar, and would love to have that conversation with you to make it impactful for you. So thanks, Naren. I really appreciate that.
Absolutely. I've read reviews. Some people even write Google reviews about meeting with you, Ryan. And I remember we even did a survey once, and I think close to like 92, 93% of them said, you know, the best marketing meeting they've ever had. So you do a good job. So at the very least, it's no cost, you know, take advantage of Ryan and his brains and his experience, you know, working with literally 100 plus, you know, hundreds of practices and really doing that marketing review for them.
Absolutely. Yes, that's fantastic. Hoping that everyone takes advantage of that. So again, businessofaesthetics.org/MSM to book a time with me. Would love to have that conversation. As we close off, anything else for Naren that you want to leave as kind of that lasting point about NAP consistency, the importance of it, and just anything we didn't cover there or anything that you really want to hit home on?
Yeah, a couple of points I want to make. SEO is about, you know, winners and losers. 5% get 95% of the traffic, 95% get almost nothing. So get into the 5% club, right? The ones who get 95% of the free traffic. Second point, to do that, there are 6 things Google cares about. And maybe we can put a link to some of the other topics, because we may have covered some of the other topics in other podcasts. So, you know, master every one of those 6. You don't need to do it. You need to understand it. And then you need to hold other people accountable. That's the secret of a successful business owner, practice owner. Three, you know, find out where you stand with NAP and all the other five things. That's what Ryan does. You know, find out. And then once you know where you stand, then decide if this is the year where you want to join the 5% club. And if so, you know, review Ryan's plan and say, okay, is this something I can get behind? You know, if not, maybe the knowledge you gain will perhaps help you the following year. So take action. That's really what I'm urging you. Just, you know, do these three things. Get into the 5% club. Understand how to get in there and stay there, you know, in the SEO 5% club. And then finally, take action, like by understanding where you stand today.
Perfect. Absolutely great points to leave on there. So thank you so much, Naren, for joining us today and breaking down NAP, which seems like a simple topic, but when you dive into it, like the impact of it is so big to your practice. And it's so important to keep your finger on the pulse of this one. As you mentioned, one of those six very key elements that you need to make sure that you're dominating the competition, you're getting all that free traffic, and you know, really leveraging everything that you've been doing to be successful and making sure that nothing is standing in your way. So thank you so much, Naren, for joining us here today. Really greatly appreciate it. And I also want to take a moment here, thank our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you. We can't do what we do without you, as you know. So please, if you like the podcast, kindly share it with your friends on social media, with your colleagues. And don't forget to write a review for us on iTunes or Google Play or wherever you're listening. It's your thoughts that are going to help other doctors, other practice owners find us and become better as well. So until we meet again, I wish everybody an amazing week ahead. Ryan Davies here signing off. Thanks, everybody, and take care.
Thank you for joining us this week on the Business of Aesthetic podcast series brought to you by our gold sponsor, Equa Marketing. Would you like to join our growing group of aesthetic industry experts and get featured on the Business of Aesthetics podcast? Or do you know someone who would love to share their strategies for growth in the aesthetic business, providing quality patient care or their clinical expertise? Head over to www.businessofaesthetics.org/podcast show and apply to be featured as a guest on the show. Remember to subscribe to this podcast on iTunes, Amazon Music, or wherever you listen. If you would like to engage with today's speakers or any of our past speakers, join our Facebook group or LinkedIn group by searching for Business of Aesthetics. Thank you and have a great day.